they sent me to Symbolics for 2 weeks to learn how to use these machines. And at that time, it was the 3600 series. The XLs hadn't been made yet. Group where I was working had a 3670, which stood about this tall, and cranked out so much heat they had to put it in the computer room. I think it was about 50,000 BTUs that it would generate. They always joked that they also had a cluster of VAX 11750s in there and 10 removable pack disk drives. And they used to joke, only half joke, about putting the operator that stayed in the room back behind the Symbolics so he could stay warm. Learning how to use the Symbolics was my first experience with Lisp. And so I did that for a while, and while I was there at Fort Gordon, we had a captain come in who had a PhD in artificial intelligence. And he was there to set up an AI lab. And so they farmed me out to him to help him with what he was doing. And we ended up with a lab that had six 3650s and six TI Explorer 1s. And it was always fun when the generals would come through. Because they, you know, there was a nice window, you could see them where the machines were all sitting in the nice cold computer room, and we were out where the classroom was done, and they would look in there and they go, "How much is one of those?" And we go, "Oh, $50,000." And that didn't bother them. They're fine. Okay. So, and then when they got around to asking how many people could use it, and we told them one at a time, they went. But that one person is more productive than all those other people on those other machines. I actually ended up teaching people how to use the Symbolics there. And then the computer science school moved into the area, and then they started going a different direction, and I came down here. Okay. Symbolics was the premier manufacturer of Lisp machines, but not the only one. TI manufactured a Lisp machine that was the Explorer. They did an Explorer 1 and an Explorer 2. Xerox even tried to get into it, but theirs was a really hokey machine. They brought one in and tried to get us to buy some. And we sat and played with it for a couple of days and decided we didn't want anything. We didn't want it even near our lab. It ran into Lisp D. It didn't have files. You didn't really save. You know, for these, you edit files, you save the file, you compile the file, you load it. They, you bring it up into an editor and you edit it and compile it that way, but you didn't really save files. I forget how it stored the stuff. But it was just really hokey, and it's like, nah, we don't want this. They were basically a bunch of PhDs out of MIT. Their first product, the LM2, was actually derived from the MIT Catter machine. Then they decided they could improve on that, and they came up with the 3600 series. And then they decided they could improve on that and shrink it down to the 3600, the CPU is a board. And they decided they could shrink that board down to a chip, and then it was a big chip. And they made the Ivory chip, which was what this XL is running. Their employees were involved in a lot of Lisp-related stuff. They were involved in the actual standardization of Common Lisp. And they worked on the CLIM specification, which is the Common Lisp Interface Manager. It shows a lot of the features that were possible in dynamic windows, which was the windowing system on this system, on the Symbolics. Just for a comparison of what was available at that time, an IBM PC had CGA display at 3 320 by 200 with four colors. Or you could go to 640 by 200 with two colors.
That's black and white.
Running Intel 8086 processor, which is a 16-bit CPU with an 8-bit bus. Imagine that. And for a total of about 2 to 20 bytes, which was, I think that's a little more than 640K, but that's about all it really addressed, was 640. And apparently the RAM could only go up to 256K. Its audio was a beep. The 3600 series machines, Symbolics, the console is black and white. But they could have a color monitor attached because they had graphics software and they needed something to show it on. They have really good graphics software. 1100 by 900 and 256 colors. What they did is you either used 1 byte of index color to get 256. I think they would do 2 bytes of index color so you could get 64K. Or you did full color, which was 16 megabytes and 16 million. And that was full 3 bytes. And actually, they used 4 bytes because you had red, green, and blue, and then they had 8 bits of alpha, which was the transparency indication on it. The 3600 processor was microcoded. When it booted up, it had to load the microcode into the processor before it could start. And so they periodically would update the microcode. You get new microcode sometimes. And so they could change what it could do just by modifying the microcode. It used a 36-bit word, hence 3600. The 36-bit word was actually 32 bits of data and 4 bits of tag. And the tag bits was how it could tell what the memory was for. One of Symbolic's really big innovations for Lisp was what they called cooter coding. And so normally what you do for a linked list is you have 2 cells. One points to the value that you're putting in that cell, and the other one points to the next cell. Well, if you had a bunch of them and they were in memory right next to each other, you drop the second part of it that points to the next one, and you just mark the first one as being cooter coded. And what that meant was, instead of having the cooter part of it that points to the next one, you're just telling it that, oh, the next one is the next memory cell. And so you almost get an index speed with memory access, with the list access, because you've got them all next to each other. And you could mix them. If you change parts of the list, you might end up with parts of the list cooter-coded and parts of it pointed off with a cooter on the cell. Let's see.
I got a question. What sorts of things were tagged?
Everything. The tags were the type. It knew what kind of what the memory was being used for.
Like, say, a number or a string or an object?
Yeah, that kind of stuff. Actually, it understood, I think there was some tag codes that meant that it was compiled code. And they actually put 2 instructions per word, and they used more than 32 bits. the top 2 bits, the tagging was the most significant 4 bits. And on the ivory chip, they actually used 8 bits. It had a 40-bit word instead of 36. The top 2 bits, at least on the ivory, were part of the cooter coding stuff to determine that. And the bottom 6 bits of the tag were the type. And so the machine knew what type everything was. You know, all the objects were typed. In C, you declare a variable and what type it is. Well, in Lisp, you just say it's a variable, and the object knows what its type is.
Were they able to optimize based on those?
Yeah.
That's kind of
the instruction set optimized a lot. Actually, the way they did it is the compiler would generate the generic code. No, it would generate the most specific code. And if the arguments you gave it were incorrect for it, it would signal an exception. And the trap that caught the exception would figure out what it really should have done and would do that code.
Oh, so it was able to...
It would do that on the
it
fly.
It was able to actually recover, but also tell
oh, yeah.
you about it and do the correct thing.
Well, it wouldn't tell you, it would just do it.
Oh,
it
would just do it.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, yeah.
I think the most common thing for like a comparison or something might be integer. And so that might be what it always coded. But if that's not what you're comparing, then it needs to use different sets of instructions to process. And so it catches the exception, shifts to what it needed to be, and does the right thing. And you don't really notice. Although you could specify, you can specify a list in the Lisp that certain variables are certain types, in which case the compiler can use that to figure out what a better way to generate the code.
At least some cool static analysis if you had all of your...
Yeah.
It sounds like it's similar to Julia, where it's multiple dispatch, where it compiles code based on the types given. You can generate...
Yeah, I don't know much about that.
Okay.
I learned a good bit about this because while I was a co-op student working there on the Army base, I had a lot of downtime. And so they give you the source code for almost everything in the machine. Except the compiler. But I learned everything I know about networking by looking at their code. I learned a good bit about how they handle memory, and it's just really fascinating. They address memory by words, they don't do bytes. So they had 2 to the 32 words, and I think that might be low, because while they had 36 byte bits, I think because of the way the tagging was done, they could use more than 32 bits for an address. They could use up some of the tag bits for address for it to be part of the address if you weren't using immediate data. And so I think it actually could address more than 2 to the 32 words, but nobody could afford that much memory, and it didn't have anywhere to put it in the cabinet. Memory wasn't as small as it is now. I would love to see one of these built now. You'd have gigabytes of RAM, or gigawords, actually. Yeah, gigawords, because it always addressed it in words, which means the C compiler they wrote that runs on this thing was atrocious.
Yeah.
Because that's a very byte-oriented language.
Yeah, in 89, 1 meg of RAM ran $600.
Yeah.
1 meg.
Now we buy that in 1 chip.
Now you can't even find it.
Yeah, that's too small.
I was gonna say you can't even find it.
Yeah, that's too small. It's like we don't mess with that.
Yeah.
Now the Symbolics 3600 series had a 16-bit audio system built into it. It was really nice. I had actually seen some people put programs together to play music on it. They didn't keep that when they went to the XLs. Like this one doesn't have it. But the 3600s did. Okay, here's a bit about the architecture. 3600s, microcoded processor, 36-bit word, 32-bit data, 4-bit tag. It used an ESDI disk, and I think some of the models had like an SMD disk, if I remember the interface right. The Ivory processor, which was sometimes referred to as Lisp on a chip, had a 40-bit word, which was still 32 bits of data, but 8 bits of tag, and it used SCSI disks and SCSI tape. They used tape as their external storage mechanism. I have a few of those at home, but I have nothing I can plug them into. memory access by word, not byte. System actually contained 2 processors. It had a front end, what they called a front end processor, which was a Motorola 68000. And on the 3600s, that one actually loaded the microcode into the Lisp processor. It manage some of the file storage space and stuff too. Their Lisp image they called a world. So it was always fun when my wife would call me, because I was sometimes going on Saturdays while I was down here to do maintenance on the machines. I was a sysadmin. And she'd say, well, what are you doing? I said, well, at the moment, I'm saving, I'm doing a garbage collection so I can save the world. Because you usually ran a big GC, and then you did the world save. Then they had the Lisp processor, which was either the 3600 or the Ivory. Hardware, LM2, 3600. The 3600, they had the 3600 itself, a 3670, a 75, a 50, a 53, a 40, a 45, a 20, and a 10. And they were getting smaller as we went. The Ivory, you had, actually it tells right here, in the XL series, which is the standalone with the console, like this is a 1201. The 1200 stood about this high. And then you had the NX series, which was a board that fit into the new bus-based Macs. And that was the MacIvory 2. There might have been a MacIvory 1. The UX series was a VME board that plugged into the Sun Unix systems. Actually, this is a VME board right here. But they actually don't use the VME bus to talk to anything. There's a CPU board, and then there's an I/O board. And they have their own connector to go between them so they can get the speed they want, because the VME bus was too slow. Then they had the NXP, which was basically something about this size, but no console. And what you had to do is you had to log in over the network, and then you would throw the console back at an X window server and run it that way. And then, let's see, they developed a graphics card for the Ivory-based systems that they called the Frame Thrower. It was more like the graphics cards you see now on the PCs. It had special processors on it for processing triangles and all that stuff, which is probably pretty advanced at the time, because I don't think PCs got it until a lot later. Frame Thrower probably came after 2000. It's probably a fairly newer one. I don't know the dates on that. Genera 8.3 is basically the last version that ran in the physical processors, physical systems. They went to Open Genera, and I think Open Genera 1 may have been 8.3 or 8.4. And then version 2 was Genera 8.5. It was a software-only version of Genera. It ran on the DEC Alpha hardware. And I actually asked them one time, because I looked at an Alpha and what it could do, and it was actually just prime for running Lisp on it, because it could do exception processing in the CPU. And I asked them about that, and they said, well, they thought about doing that, but then they would be too tied to it or something. I forget what it was, but they didn't do it that way. And the Open Genera came with almost all the layered products. I think the graphics was the only thing it didn't have, and that's probably because they had sold it by then. Numerical calculations were faster than in Fortran on the big machines that ran Fortran normally. These machines are nearly impossible to crack. Anything that causes an exception, they generally catch it, and you end up in the debugger. If you are bad enough that you crash the Lisp debugger, you will land in the FET debugger. They made one of them made a cameo appearance in the movie Real Genius. if you watch the movie, when they near the beginning of the movie, when they go down, I think it's somebody's lab, and they're kind of panning across, you'll see the console for a Symbolics in what they see as they pan by. I don't know if it's running anything or anything. I don't know. It's been so long since I saw the movie, I don't remember any of it. I just remember noticing it when it went by and said, oh, that's a Symbolics. I did find out that they actually used a Symbolics and its graphics software to do some animation clips for that movie. Their software was used to develop flocking motion. I think they referred to, they had something called voids, VOIDS. And they actually made a little short film for SIGGRAPH that demonstrated the flocking by having a set of birds and a set of fish. So they were showing schooling and flocking. And the movies, the little shorts called Stanley and Stella and Breaking the Ice. You can go on YouTube and look it up and find about four or five different versions of it. It runs about 3 minutes. And basically you've got a sphere with an ice in at the center, and below the ice is water with fish swimming around, and above it is these mechanical looking birds. And one of the fish and one of the birds see each other, and the bird goes up and then crashes down to break the ice. And so he falls through the ice and he's kind of unconscious, and she comes up and nudges him some and wakes him up, and then the fish and the birds start mingling between them. It's interesting to watch. That movie was rendered on a farm of 3600 based machines, and the software was such that it would manage the stuff by farming a frame out to one machine, and if something happened and it never brought the frame back, it would farm that frame out to another machine. The operating system for the machine was written in what they call Lisp machine Lisp from MIT, and Symbolics later started calling it Zeta Lisp. Its object system was called Flavors. And because there's a ice cream place near MIT that the students hung out in a lot, the ice cream place, you get your flavor of ice cream, and then they had stuff you could sprinkle on top. They called them mix-ins. So if you look through the source code for the operating system, you will see them referring to mix-ins. And what they are is classes that don't do anything by themselves, but you combine them with some of the other flavors and mix them in, and then they add functionality to the overall. And they did almost everything in that. It's a very object-oriented system from a software point of view. They actually had their own version control system. And it would embed information in the files to keep track of what version the file was at and what branch it was on and that kind of thing. And they had a hypertext-linked online documentation system, which I think we're going to show on OpenGenera, because I don't have the files for it, and they're not the same version. That system, that documentation system, was really nice. You could bring up a page, and if it had references to other topics or other parts of the documentation, you'd click on them and it'd take you over there. And it kept track of the stack of how you got there, and you could back out of it. I imagine that a lot of the hypertext linking that you see today is probably people that knew about some of these and basically wanted to implement them other ways.
What year was that?
Back in the 80s.
The early 80s?
Yeah.
So
this documentation system's been around as long as a machine has.
So it was maybe 8 or 9 years before HTML.
Oh, yeah.
About, so not too many years before, but I'm just trying to put it.
But yeah, it wasn't like the next day or anything.
Yeah.
You know? And actually, if you used one of these, the development cycle for it is just unbelievable. Everything is lives in the same memory space. The operating system, the editor, the compiler, whatever code you're working on. And so you can flip back and forth. You can actually sit in the editor, and there's a key combination you hit that compiles the definition that the cursor's in. I know some of the IDEs around these days can do that too, but they probably got it from this one. Because there are people that used to work for Symbolics that have gone all kinds of places. Java was designed by Lisp people. Some of those were Symbolics people that ended up over at Sun. Actually, one of them was Guy Steele, and he's the person who edited the first Lisp, Common Lisp book before the final standard.
He has a great quote on Java. It said, we tried to drag the C programmers to Lisp, but we got about halfway there.
Well, I looked at Java, and my assessment is it's the worst of Lisp and the worst of C, mashed together into a single language.
Why do you say that?
It looks like C, but it tries to be Lisp. It has the dynamic memory aspects of Lisp. Garbage collection, and you create stuff, but it has all the syntax of C. You have to declare types on all the variables. It's just a real pain. Whereas in Lisp, you don't declare types on the variable; the data itself has the type. Let's see. Source code for most of the software is included, which can be quite entertaining. Some of the comments they have in there. And it can certainly be informative if you're looking through the code, figuring out how they're doing stuff.
Is that online anywhere to look at source code for this type of thing?
No. You have to know somebody that has the source code.
Yeah.
You can actually decompile, you can disassemble functions and get them. But I think I actually decompiled a file and got a disassembled version of an entire file. Because when I started working here, we were using a system called ICAD, which was a sort of a CAD-type thing that ran on top of Symbolics. Later, they switched away from Symbolics and moved to Allegro, Common Lisp. But they had this neat little thing that they had designed. They would put at the bottom of the screen that was a GC thermometer. And it would show you how much memory you got, and it had little markers showing aspects of the garbage collection system. And I thought that was so cool, I found the binary file for it, and I decompiled it and converted it back to Lisp. I actually have it loaded on the system right here.
Oh, cool.
So it's actually, if you're in the middle of debugging something and you disassemble a function, even if it's not yours, if it's like a system function, you can look at it, and because of the way they do function calls and stuff, you can almost see sort of the Lisp that's behind it. Now, macros will throw you for a loop, because the way they work macros is they evaluate the macro, and then they compile the result. And so the function definition objects will tell you which macros were expanded inside the code, but you've got to figure out where. Because all you're going to see is the disassembled version of the expanded macro.
Oh, yeah.
They manage memory in what they call regions. They did have a generational garbage collector, but within the generation, they had these areas that were called regions. Actually, they had something called areas, too. I forget which are the regions of the areas, but one of them would only hold one type of object. To tell it which type it would hold. And so it was very common for them to have at least one of those areas that was nothing but con cells. And then you'd have another one that would take just normal object instances and do that. But you could actually interact with that yourself in your program, and if it would make your program work better, you could actually use them the way you want to, as outside of their system. You know, they made their garbage collection system so that you could adjust it, and if it was going to be helpful to you. They supported about every known network protocol that existed at the time. Their native one was called ChaosNet. And so between two Lisp machines, they usually talked to ChaosNet. TCP/IP came along, and you can actually run ChaosNet over TCP/IP, which will let it route out into the internet, which ChaosNet itself won't do.
What's like one of the distinguishing features of ChaosNet? Like, what would it give you on top of TCP/IP or?
Well, it had its own protocols for like file transfers and text communication. It actually had a network file system called Infile that in Lisp. They have an object called path name, and the path name has a directory component, a name component, a type component, and a version component. And on the Symbolics, it had a few extras that were for some of these other file systems. I think they call it a host. Well, you have a host component, and they also had like a device component, because if you were on DentNet talking to a VAX, you needed to know the device that your head of the file existed on. And Infile actually passed that level of information across. You know, that's how you addressed files, was to get at that kind of information. You didn't have this long string with separated characters. You actually broke the thing up for it to pass over, and it would go. There were actually ChaosNet server implementations, I think, for Unix, and maybe even for the VAX. They did DECnet. That was entertaining. When I was at Fort Gordon, we had a micro-VAX that we had attached to our network. We had a lieutenant colonel, I think he was, from Korea come over. He was stationed in Korea. To work on a program that would predict flooding on the rivers near there in Korea. And he used the micro-VAX. Apparently that's what they had back at his place. We actually discovered a bug while he was working. He was trying to do something windowed, and in VAX Lisp, the windows were all def structs. And you're supposed to be able to take a def struct and include it in another def struct in Lisp, and almost like inheritance. But it didn't work. And he said, come here, look at this. And he told me what he was trying to do. And he showed me the code, and I looked at this. Well, that's, you know, you wrote what, it should be doing what you're wanting it to do. And so we poked at it for a minute and said, but it's not. So I sent an email up to DEC and showed them, you know, told them what was going on. And they poked around and they said, yep, you're right, that's a bug. And they sent us a patch. So when he finished his stuff, when we dumped his stuff on the tape for him to take with him, we dumped the patch on the tape with him so he could have that too. They did NFS, and NFS is probably one of the better ways to talk to other machines if you're not going to use the ChaosNet stuff, because over NFS, it can still do version numbers on the files. But it'll only go up through version 2 of NFS, because 3 and 4 didn't exist at the time. They came along later. And it can do IBM SMA. Never used it, don't know what all it can do. But they had that. Concordia was the program that creates their documentation. And while it's online and available as hypertext, you can actually print it, send it to the printer, and get printed documents out of it. And that's what they used it for that. Early on, you usually ended up with one set of printed documentation per site. And after a while, they quit doing that. It had a C compiler. The code produced was extremely slow because C is a byte-oriented language. They had a Fortran compiler. Never used it, never needed to. They actually could do Prolog, which was a little more fitting. And they had a Pascal compiler. I was thinking they had a COBOL compiler, but I couldn't find any references that mentioned it, so maybe they didn't. Which is good. That was a business thing. Keep that away from my machine. They had really nice computer modeling and animation software. It was in multiple parts. The S-geometry was the modeling part. S-render is what actually created the pictures, rendered the frames. S-dynamics was doing the was how they automated the animation for it. And S-paint was just letting you make, paint on your objects or whatever you wanted to do. They had the original flocking motion. They did the short for it. And yeah, you can look it up on YouTube and watch it. Did you ever find it? I told you about it.
I did. We'll play it after.
Okay.
There's one of those here, so we can play it.
Yeah, it's only 3 minutes, so it's not that bad. They did have an X11 server, but it's what they did is they took the reference one that was written in C, and they compiled it with their C compiler. And so it worked, but it was excruciatingly slow. And I moved down here to work on a project for the Navy. And when we got the project finished, we had to take it up to Indianapolis to deploy it. So while I was in Indianapolis for a month, I found a really nice bookstore. And it had the entire set of X11 manuals for the documentation for the protocol. And so I bought Volume 0, which was the base protocol. And it was interesting. They should have written that in a Lisp. It would have worked a lot better. And X11 was actually designed to support that. It understood that Lisp didn't have all the bits available, but it needed some of them to do other things. And so it was written so that some of the stuff you passed didn't need all the bits in the word. Like I said, theirs was excruciatingly slow. Layered software, they had an object-oriented database system called STES. Some of the people that worked on that left the company and started another company to continue that. And I forget the name of it now. At TCPIT, at NFS, SNA, DECNET. Then they had something called Joshua, which was their expert system. This machine is the ultimate integrated development environment. Everything exists in the same memory space. The editor, the compiler, debugger, everything. Even the operating system. And so you can sit in an editor, edit your files, save them, compile individual definitions. They actually have a fairly fancy keyboard and lots of extra keys on it. And you could hit suspend and it would pop down a Lisp listener. Type in your Lisp and run the program. And you get ready to go back editing, you abort the Lisp listener and go back to the editor. Or you could their windowing system shows one window at a time. And so what they did is to move from one program to the other, you hit a select key and then a letter that tells it which one you want to go to. And select L was for the Lisp listener. And then select E would take you to the editor, which was an Emacs-based editor. They had a select F, which was the file system editor. You could look at the files on the disk, on your disk, a FET disk, or even one of the hosts out on the network. They had several others. I forget what all the codes were for them.
Just a
selected to go around. When he was first talking to me about showing this machine, I spent 1 weekend playing with it just to kind of see what I had available for it. I was looking, checking for documentation. I didn't have any of that. It takes up lots of space. I have a very small disk in that thing. And so Monday, when I'm back working again, I keep trying to go select L. I keep reaching to go select L to get back to somewhere to type in to run my program. And it's like, whenever you printed something in the Lisp listener, if it was an object, it would become sensitive under the right context. And that was part of dynamic windows. And so you could run a program that generated a lot of output, and if the output came from other objects, when they got printed, those parts where they printed would be sensitive, and the underlying object that caused those to be printed would be available. And you could click right on them and get a menu of things you could do to the object. You could examine it or whatever. But it made debugging real easy, because you generate output, you go, oh, what's that? Let's describe that. Let's see what that looks like. Ooh, let's describe that. See what that looks like. And you just follow this chain down until you forget how you got there. They're nearly crash-proof. They've been known to run for months without rebooting. Usually people would complain that theirs was no longer running for their record because the power in the building had blinked and the machine went down. Although, I have seen some of the machines survive brownout level power fluctuations. You know, if the power only went down a little and came back up, they didn't even notice. They just kept going. They had such big capacitors in their power supplies that they didn't even notice it went down. There are a few that went for like a couple of years, and one was even being used to edit the documentation at Symbolics. And that's creating and destroying lots of memory to process all that. They're kind of a multimodal GC. They have a generational GC. Normally when it runs, they call it ephemeral. It runs the newest, it checks the newest stuff to clean that up, because that's where most of the trash occurs. But if you got bad enough, if you went long enough that you had so little memory available, you could run the in-place garbage collector. The ephemeral collector would actually create a new area or a new region, and copy from one region to the other region, the normal copy thing. The in-place collector would look at what was there, find the pieces that were going to be garbage, and it would start to move objects into that space and pack them in, making room for other things to move around. And so it could run when no other garbage collector could run. But it might take it a long time because it's analyzing the memory and figuring out what it can do. So you must need what's in memory really bad to run that way and not just reboot it. I did run it a couple of times. This particular machine has 4 megawords of memory, which is roughly 20 megabytes, because it's running, well, it runs 4.5 bytes per word.
4.5, okay.
Yeah, because it's 36-bit. Well, 40 bits.
Okay.
Actually, that's 5 bytes. Yeah. The 3600 was 4.5. Yeah, this one's 5 bytes, because it gets a whole byte of tag bits. Because of the disk I have is so small, I only have 36 megabytes of virtual memory. When we start running this thing, if you hear it going, making noise, that's it paging memory in and out. This was one that was a host of machines being used by American Express. I'm not sure what they were doing with them, but they decommissioned them and went to something else. They probably switched to like a leg rail or something. And so they were selling them to those of us that knew what they were for like $500. It's like, I'll take one. The original price of that machine is $30,000 when it was new.
What year is that?
I'm not sure what year this came out, but it was somewhere in the 80s, mm-hmm. probably toward the later part, because the smaller machines came out later than the bigger ones. Mm-hmm. Sort of like, come out with the big one, and then they make them smaller. Mm-hmm. And now it's basically a large paperweight that generates lots of heat. And that concludes that presentation. Somebody took the Open General and figured out how to make it run on non-alpha machines, so that you basically could run it on like a PC, as long as you had like a 64-bit PC, and it needs all the bits.
Well, it's a little bit of a lie, because it's running in an alpha emulator.
Right, that's what the thing is, they made an alpha emulator.
So yeah, this Symbolics Lisp machine is running on a Mac. The Mac is running VirtualBox, so it boots up Linux. Linux itself is then running the alpha emulator,
yes.
which is running OpenGenera. But it works.
Yeah.
And that's kind of cool. Let's make the screen a little bigger.
And considering the speed of these machines versus the speed of that one, this machine, the CPU is running at about 30 or 40 megahertz. Instead of, you know, 1 gigahertz plus, you know, some of these laptops are running 2, 3, 4 gigahertz.
Not really any easier to see.
No. I tried to, for that when they came out with the NXP, they actually converted all their fonts to TrueType, because the NXP wants to talk to an X server, and so the X server needed to have all the fonts. And I had those at one time, because one place I worked, we had an NXP. And I thought I kept a copy of them, but I couldn't find it. And I couldn't find them out on the web either, because I was going to use the Symbolics font in the presentation.
Gotcha.
I thought that would have been cool to put Symbolics in that font.
Yeah, yeah. So what did the font look like?
That's it right
there.
Okay,
cool.
Yeah, this is the Symbolics font.
Okay.
And it's the font they used for their logo on the machines, and they use it in the software.
So we're viewing this machine, but through this.
No, no. You're viewing a virtual machine.
Just a virtual machine.
Yeah.
Okay.
You're toward the end of the life of the company, they decided to go to an all software thing they called a virtual Lisp machine.
Mm-hmm.
And what they did is they ran it normally on a DEC Alpha processor, and somebody figured out that these machines are now fast enough to run a DEC Alpha emulator and still have decent speed. And so what he's running is an emulator for the Alpha, and then running OpenGenera on top of that.
Would you like to run this and show some things?
Okay.
The select key is F1.
Yeah.
So you go to
and 6 of abort. They had a key called abort. And it was very helpful. If you got stuck somewhere, you hit abort. And if that didn't get you out, you hit control abort. And if you're really stuck, it's control meta abort.
Wow.
The Symbolics keyboard actually has multiple shift keys. They call them modifier keys.
Like control all.
You have control, meta, super, hyper. That was
shift.
Main one. Yeah, oh yeah, they hit shift. That's true, they did have shift.
Yeah, I think you can simulate hyper on regular keyboards with some.
A lot of times, like on a PC keyboard, they'll use the Alt key as meta. I think Emacs does that. And sometimes they use the little Windows key for something, I forget which. But let's see. Can't see up close with my glasses.
Oh, that's a missile.
Let's see. Let's go get. I can use that. Oh, you've already got some. Yeah, all the documentation is available. These are the actual volumes of the documentation set. And you just pick one and it displays over here. And as you read through, some parts of it are sensitive, like with open file. And so you click on that, and now, see, it's making a stack of bookmarks of places you've been. And now it's telling you the function with open file and variables for the function and a description of what it can do. And, oh, look, we can go other places. And but you could go through the whole thing that way. It keeps track of how you got there. You can go pick one and we could say, well, now we want to go back where we started, and we go back to there, and it remembers where within the document you were when you left. Mm. So you will go back to literally where you were.
Is this what you meant by the tiling? As far as the
I think this is what I was thinking of when I thought of the tiling.
Yeah, they're.
What's the show candidate show documentation? What show candidates?
If you want to search the documentation, you do show candidates and tell it what you want it to look for.
Okay.
And then it'll I think up here it'll give you a list of things that it found that matched your criteria. And so then you can pick them and go through. Let's see. One nice thing, and you probably can't see it very well on this because it's down low, is at the bottom of the screen, the very bottom line of the screen,
here?
Yes, there, is a kind of status line. On the left, it has the date and the clock, and then it tells who's logged in. It would have the name of the person logged in.
Yeah, that's cool.
And then next, it tells you some stuff about the mode it's in. This is actually the package name of what its current package is. And then it tells you what state the window system is in. Right now it's in a user input mode, waiting for somebody to do something. You know, use the mouse, click the keyboard. And then over on the right it tells you that it's reading a file, and it tells you the name of the file. It tells you that it's read the whole thing, it's at 100% right now. And so some of this status stuff down here changes. The two lines up above that are what they call the mouse line. As you go over and you point at things, the mouse line changes and tells you that if you click the left mouse button, it'll do show documentation on the thing I'm pointing at. If I do middle mouse button, it'll do an overview of what I'm pointing at. And if I click right, it'll give me a menu of things I can do.
That's really helpful.
Oh yeah, you get used to it. Because you start pointing at things and looking at that line and kind of going, okay, what's this thing going to do? And some of them...
The thing about this is most everything on the screen here is alive. You can point at it.
Oh, yeah.
Do something.
And it's all meaningful. It's like meaningful in place. It's probably pretty necessary for what you were doing.
And actually, that mouse line changes as you hold down modifier keys.
That's nice.
Let's see. There's control.
Marker.
And you can combine the modifier keys. So you can do control, meta, control meta, hyper, control hyper, meta hyper, control meta hyper.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you you can assign, you can have it do things based on the combination. Dynamic windows, when you would define things in the interface, you would talk about gestures, and those were the gestures. And you would say, well, you know, if you get this gesture, go do this. You know, call this function. And so you could assign gestures, you assign all those gestures to something if you wanted to, and they'd show up in this line down here. I can't show you the file system editor because that was the one of the pieces they didn't put in the virtual Lisp machine. I found something talking about that, and it was talking about things that didn't go into the virtual, into the VLM, and the file system stuff was part of it. Let's see. select key and tell it where you want to go. And if you hit select and then hit, not that one, select and help. Oh,
it does the wrong one too.
Hold
the punch key maybe.
See, F12 is help. Your F12 is.
You want to hold down function
F12.
Yeah,
yeah,
so
so
they have like a regular.
It, with the exception F12. Of the F1 key.
Oh.
So
if
you hit
so F1
function
F12. If you select help, then you get a list of all the things you can go to. And so it tells you that if you hit the equals key, you go to the select key selector. I think that lets you change the bindings on it. Converse was their texting app. You could go into Converse and you could talk to people on other machines, on other Lisp machines. That was another one of those things that ran over ChaosNet.
That's cool.
And yeah, it was actually kind of neat. It's an early IM app.
So where would that pop up if you were...
It takes over the whole screen.
Okay,
it,
so if someone
comes
sent you a
window.
Message, it would just take over your screen? Or
well, no, if somebody sent you something, you might get a notification. What is it? Converse is C. And what here, you would type in the host that you want to talk to,
mm-hmm.
or maybe the person and the host. I forget how it went.
Did it work like Unix's talk?
I don't remember. I never used talk. It probably could interact with some of the application here might could interact with some of the other texting mechanisms and other, like TCP. I'm not sure which one, because I think maybe it could do talk. So I think it might have been able to talk to a Unix host over talk. I'm pretty sure it could talk to DetNet over whatever they had. I forget what it was called. But you could do that, and you could type to them and select, go somewhere else and do something. And, as the machine has things happen, it will notify you about them. And so you can select this notification application just to see the history of things that have been notifications you received. And they're all date and time stamped. And because this thing gets booted in a non-normal way, it always has some. The way you normally do is you get the machine, you allocate space to it, and you have to create the Lymphus system, which was their file system. It's a Lisp machine file system. And for short, we always called it Lymphus, because it was abbreviated LMFS, and which was just a file in the FET file system. And so what you would do is you would start the machine up, you'd have to load whatever the current namespace was for your site, then you would save an incremental world that had that namespace in it, and once that was done, it could get updates to the thing whenever it booted up. The namespace knew what hosts were on your network and what services they could provide. And over what protocols? Probably the easiest way to show that is to go back to the Lisp listener and do.
Trying to delete.
Yeah.
Control D.
Control D.
Yes. That does a delete in place, not.
Oh no no no! I want. No, that's not it.
Control D.
Oh, you don't have a delete key.
Yeah.
Okay. So I don't know what key does it on yours.
I just do Control D.
I think you can do function.
Okay.
Delete as well.
The Symbolics had what they call a rub-out key.
Yeah.
And it was where the left pinky was. Which on everybody else's keyboard is a caps lock key.
It was really funny being in the house when he had been using the Symbolics and they switched back to a PC and he was trying to use the robot key and he's like, nah, it's not there.
I rebind my caps lock to control, so every time I use anyone else's computer, I'm always like,
I've seen people set up bindings like that in Emacs because they wanted certain keys in a, they would like swap caps lock and control or something. And it was because that's what they were used to. Well, you get on one of those and you get used to that rub out key on your left pinky. And boy, is it nice. One of the extra keys was complete input, which was how you asked it to take what you typed and figure out what was missing. Ah! For some reason I can't get my fingers aligned on this keyboard. Okay, let's try this again. A year or two ago, I found this project for converting a Symbolics keyboard into a USB device so you could plug it into a different computer. And now their project involved taking this little circuit board and sticking it inside the keyboard, and it ceased to be a Symbolics keyboard. I'm like, no, I can't do that. I need it to plug into the Symbolics because it doesn't understand USB. So what I was going to do is take the little board and put it in a box and have the little connector for the Symbolics keyboard on one side and the USB on the other. I just hadn't got around to finishing it. Actually, this we could do on there. That's true. But then everybody has to gather around. We can't put it up there.
All six of us.
Yeah, that can actually work.
I've got the video up on my computer whenever we're ready to watch that.
Oh, okay.
It's an artist. The one that was on Symbolics.
Yeah. My son. Yeah, you've got hyper super meta control shift. They even had a key called symbol, which is sort of a modifier, too.
What about these shifts here?
Those are just. There, you can use them for whatever you want. And so whenever I was writing a program that I didn't really plan to keep or anything, I would set them up so that I could do select square or select circle or select triangle.
So this is a wild card.
Yeah, it's just something that the system doesn't use. It's something you can use. Yeah.
Styling is
Incidentally, this is a Logitech mouse.
Okay. That's great. This is a little mouse.
Yeah. That's basically a phone cord.
Yeah.
RJ11.
Awesome.
Hmm?
Is it RJ11?
It probably is. There weren't too many of those. It's RJ11 and RJ45, which is a network connector. Let's see. This has the nice rub-out key on the pinky.
It's actually called
Rub-out. And then you have select.
That's really funny. I like it when it's just not obvious.
I can show you the file system editor on this one.
The font is nice.
They did draw black on a white background because that's easier on your eyes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
This is the local. Their file system was version. All the files have a version number on them. Show you this. The namespace is stored in the files, and what they did is it would be these object definitions. And this is a host, the name of the host, which was this one, this film, and it has It can provide configuration service over, it can provide configuration service over TCP via a configuration protocol. Yeah. It can do file service over TCP using infile, and it can do file service over TCP using TCP FTP, and on down.
Mm-hmm.
It has an internet address of 192.168.5.5. If it was a chaos address, it would, if it was on ChaosNet, it would say address chaos, and then it would be an octal number.
Mm-hmm.
It tells the system type, this is a Lisp machine. It uses that information to figure out what the path names need to look like.
Okay.
If you look at a path name object in memory, you'll get different ones for talking to a Lisp machine host as opposed to talking to a Unix 4.2 host. And then this particular machine is an XL1201. The name of the site is CTL. It also has its own definition. You can actually put most of this information into a DNS server. These would be called WKS records. And so I think they were actually looking ahead to a time when this stuff would be stored in the DNS server locally, and the machines wouldn't need to do it. They would just look it up on the DNS server, but they never got around to getting that far. So this one describes my network at home. So I was going to show. Oh yeah, it wasn't doing that for me. Aha!
Once everyone starts to show.
Yeah. So we want to show. Namespace object.
Now you should be able to click on those, right?
Actually, you can. That's true.
If this is a thing. Everything that scrolls up is usually clickable.
Oh, click that.
Nice.
So, by week, we're at the finish page.
Is this part of the magic of the tag memory?
This is the magic of not having very much memory.
Okay.
It's only got 4 megawords. Let's see. And so you can see what we saw in the text file. But you could get that in there, and all this stuff is sensitive. Basically, it's just a symbol. You can describe it, which is highly unuseful. It will just say, configuration is a symbol in the keyword package. We can do that, and you can see what it says. Tells you where the source file is.
Yeah, but you can, like, for instance, define a function, and then it'll tell you what it is. Can you show us how to do that?
I can, actually, you can... Oops. There's complete. Okay, fine. Disable this now display distribution distribute system. Oh.
Looking for disassemble?
Yeah, I thought it was disassemble command. Maybe it's just a function. Not very big. Things that's actually one of the CPU's instructions.
So it says cars SP pop.
Yeah, basically that's an instruction for the processor. And SP pop means just pop the argument off the stack and then call car with it. And then you return it back on the stack. You can see the GC thermometer down there.
Nice.
I thought it was so cool. I disassembled it so I could have the source. I haven't gotten a chance to try to compile it on the VLM yet, though, to see if it'll work.
It'll probably be a lot longer.
You know,
with a bar on there.
Oh. I don't know. Yeah.
Well, there's a lot better garbage collectors
nowadays.
You can write your own garbage collector and see if it actually works. Then you can do it on the virtual version. And then upload it to this one if it actually does work. And if it doesn't, it'll erase the machine.
Let's see. Actually, you don't have to hit enter. When you hit the close parenthesis, if it's the last one, it runs right then.
Oh, interesting.
And it has lowercase parentheses over here.
Lowercase parentheses.
Yeah, you don't have to hit shift to get them. Most keywords have to hit shift to get the parentheses.
So you can do either way.
So it has parentheses in a lowercase position, so you don't have to hold shift. Since you use them so much.
Yeah, it's using default all the time. You can move the mouse over A and see that it points to this. Everything that scrolls up, as I mentioned, is alive.
Let's see. Here we go. Ha! We can point that, which is a file name. We can describe that. This is a path name. This is a logical path name, as opposed to a physical path name.
Mm-hmm.
On Symbolics, they put a lot more information in here. This file, sys configuration, contains these definitions, these flavors, these types. A network-defined protocol, a server definition, a command definition, and then there's a logical host sys. This is the printed string for it. Let's see. But anyway, click on any of this if you want to, and we'll look at what they did say. This tells you who wrote the file, and this is the date stamp for when, and some of these might be the version number. We'll see.
The highlighting's good.
Clem does a lot of this kind of stuff. This was the part of dynamic windows that they copied. Where they had Symbolics people helping them, which is why they copied it.
Scrolling over here.
Yeah, it's
works
scroll.
By other clicking buttons. I forget.
Yeah, you left and right.
Yeah.
One goes up, one goes down. And in, I think middle it says jump to this position.
Hmm.
But no scroll wheel. And I'm used to the scroll wheel. Let's see. These were in the late 80s.
Okay. What kind of projects were these used, like in the military? Like, what made them?
Well,
why would they want these particular machines?
Because of the Lisp processing. Basically, these are. I don't think of it so much as a functional programming system as much as I do an object-oriented programming system. Mm-hmm. And when I went to work there at Fort Gordon, there was a lieutenant working there that was working. He was the one using the Symbolics that was there in the office. And he was working on a project to simulate the Army's up-and-coming communication system for the battlefield. Basically, it was cell phones. They called it mobile subscriber equipment, MSE. what he did, and he had the color screen, and he would display a random placement of the communications nodes on a background, and you could go in and you could click with the mouse and you could delete nodes as though they got blown up in the battle, and it would reconfigure the network on the fly and to show what was going to happen. But it's interesting that the military would even use one of these, because this is about as unsecure as you can get. There's no way you can make this a secure system.
Yeah. People log in access, you have everything.
You can always log in as Lisp machines.
Can you redefine functions out from under?
Oh, yeah. So. You can redefine functions that are part of the operating system.
Right. And someone runs it and it self-destructs
or whatever. You'd have to be really good to do that, though.
Oh, yeah. you could send the password off over ChaosNet before logging in.
Yeah. Let's see. I don't know what else the military used them for, but they were really good if you were trying to do simulation or something. I actually had 3 students come through that were from Fort Monmouth? No, that was not them. One of the forts out in Kansas, where the prison was, the military prison. They were at that fort. They weren't part of the prison, but they were doing other stuff. It was 2 civilians and a major. And they were doing battlefield simulation. They were supposed to do it in Key when they got back. But they basically implemented all the pieces they needed. I think the major did the attrition algorithms, and the 2 civilians worked on the interface to show it all. And then they had to go back and do it a different one when they got there. But it was good for that kind of stuff. I actually use Lisp to do stuff now, not on this one. I use Common Lisp on a PC.
Is there any? We're starting to run short on time.
Yeah.
Is there anything else we need to know?
For this machine, that's probably about it. When I found the project to convert this to unit to a USB keyboard, I told him he can't have it.
I was just playing around with the keyboard. So yeah.
This probably actually this does weigh more than a MacBook Air.
Yeah. Oh yeah. this is not a light keyboard.
You can beat someone to death with that easily.
But
it's
really nice typing.
I thought my mouse keyboard was heavy.
It's
about 5 times as heavy as that one.
This is probably as heavy as some of the computers.
That's what he was saying.
And this is a small one. The older ones were thicker. they thinned it down in the later years. But to sit and type on this is just a wonderful keyboard. You could hit it all you wanted, and it wasn't going to mess it up or anything. And you'd hear people.
Yeah, I can't get on like Skype calls or like Zoom meetings and like type
back
and mute myself because everyone will complain.
All right. It's like you use those things, you have to basically be a touch typist. But if you're a touch typist on this, you ain't going to get nowhere. Because those keys take a little force.
Well, thank you very much, Craig.
Yeah.
If you want to sit and play with it and try, try the keyboard out or something, have at it.
I have to run to the Mac store really quickly, but I'll meet you guys over at Leaf if that's cool.
That's great.
And thank you for switching to an electrical iPhone.
No,
there's
a
signal
in the server.
Yeah, I'll meet you guys over there.
Actually, you probably get the wind by hitting symbol.